How are you making sure that your highly sensitive information is protected while you're running it? Hi, my name is Alex Greer from the IBM Cloud team, and make sure to like and subscribe. So before I get started talking about confidential computing, I want to talk a little bit about why it's such an exciting field. So confidential computing, among other reasons, is exciting for the fact that we're seeing cross-collaboration in the tech space to actually drive the technology forward. And so it's awesome to see people reaching across a competitive aisle to do that, a lot of bright minds. The second is that the technology is going to directly complement the existing data encryption paradigm that we have today and make it an even more complete end-to-end story. So before I get into the actual technology and some of the use and value behind it, let's start with the existing pillars of data encryption today. So you start with protecting your data while it's at rest. So when you're storing it. So we've got at rest. You can think of this as whatever information you'd like to. We'll just represent it simply here. Now we have information that we want to transist from point to point. So in order to do that securely, we need to protect it while it's in transit. So we say in transit. But what's missing in today's story is this third pillar here. What are you doing to protect it while you're actually running it? The groups that you're going to have to protect yourself against, one, are malicious actors who want to do things like scrape that data. You're also going to want to protect against memory dumps, things of that nature. We have the inevitable threat that we have to protect against, which is insider threats. And in addition, we also have a lot of collaboration that we want to go on between us and either a trusted vendor or even a trusted technology partner. But at the same time, we really don't want to expose a piece of highly sensitive information to them, even though we want them to be able to take advantage of it. So we've got also our partners and vendors here. How can we ensure that this information is not only not visible to these parties, but also protected from the worst case scenario? That's where confidential computing goes in. So let's talk about what confidential computing looks like. We'd earlier talked about the collaboration across technology leaders in the space. We at IBM are a part of the Confidential Computing Consortium, so the definition that we follow for confidential computing is as such. Confidential computing is a hardware-based technology that allows for the physical partitioning of memory at the server level. So let's draw our stack. Got our hardware level on the bottom, which is where the actual physical partitioning of the memory is going to take place. And then we have the middleware level. And then for the example, but not exclusive to, we're going to talk about a containerized abstraction of this. So we're going to have containers here. So what's taking place is that at the hardware level, we have that physical partitioning of the memory, which allows for you to actually run that application in its own silo. So the silo in the scenario that we've painted here is going to be called an enclave. So we've got an enclave here, 1, 2, 3, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So these enclaves can have applications run in that physically isolated environment, but let's take a look into more detail about what that actual enclave is. So the enclave itself functions like a black box, so to speak. This black box or enclave has that data that we spoke about earlier. We'll make it the same one from our previous example. But what it also has in here are the set of techniques or the things that, or the actual processing and the procedures for that processing that information. So we've got our techniques here. What this system does in a scenario in which we had the malicious actor from earlier, we had the insider threat, and we even had our own partners. What it does is it has an encryption key that it only extends out to the authorized program that allows for that authorized program to decrypt the information running within this physically isolated silo and to be able to actually perform its set of processes. So this authorized program can do so. But that key is not extended to the other parties. So that write privilege, since it's not offered here, prevents the access for a malicious actor. It prevents the access to an insider threat. And then finally, it even prevents access to a partner. What actual access is it preventing now? This is access to modify that code as well as to view that data while it's actually inside this physically partitioned silo. But what's really important for our design is that we verify that the interaction with that code or data was what we hope for it to be. So we need to have what we refer to as attestation reports. So attestation reports, you can see here, attestation reports. And just for good measure, we've got in here that encryption key that we talked about. So let's get back to the key value proposition we just discussed. So what this secure enclave, this black box, allowed us to do, it gave us a data and code integrity that we didn't have before. One, it reduced the visibility of that data while it was being run only to the authorized program itself. So we have restricted visibility. The second is that it took that data and it actually prevented these parties from making any sort of undue modification to the actual code itself. So no mod or unauthorized mod. And then what we were able to do was verify the actual interaction with that code and that data via attestation reports, which is very critical for corroborating the story that our system is telling us. So now let's look at the use cases that have been enabled. So the first use case here we're going to talk about is multi-party computing. Multi-party computing, coming down to right here, we're actually working with a technology partner. It allows for us to take highly sensitive information and exchange it with other parties without actually exposing it. So therefore, what we can do is we can share data sets. We can actually collaborate and perform functions commonly on top of highly sensitive information. So you can think about maybe a collaboration between two research institutions who otherwise in the past had to go around a very complicated path for actually getting approval to exchange that information. Now they've got that quick and easy path by simply not allowing that information to be exposed to the other party. The next case that we're going to talk about is IP. So IP, you can think of that next great discovery that your company is making. Perhaps you've discovered some sort of pharmaceutical innovation and you have the actual the blend and the chemical composition and the other things that are unique about your solution. And you're wanting to actually share that with another party, but again, without exposing that information to them. So this is another great scenario where you're protected. Now, the final one, it's a real situation that we all have to tackle today, is that we give the keys to the kingdom, essentially, to the people that we trust and we hire. But an insider threat is always a possibility. So we have to protect our workloads from that possibility. So we have insider threats here. And now we've protected ourselves from even the case in which our own turn on us. So now that we've got the use cases laid out, you can see the clear value that is provided by confidential computing. Confidential computing is focused on protecting application data while you're actually running it. And it allows for us to be able to collaborate more freely with other parties, as well as protect ourselves in a new way from malicious actors, whether external or internal. Thank you for listening.
If you have questions, please drop us a line below. If you want to see more videos like this in the future, please like and subscribe. And don't forget, you can grow your skills and earn a badge with IBM Cloud Labs, which are free browser-based interactive Kubernetes labs.